This is Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. Thank you for joining us today. We are extremely happy to have with us Mr. Anthony Laciura, a great compromario tenor of his time. And in addition to his singing career, he's also well known as an actor, a director, and a teacher. Welcome, Anthony.
Well, thank you for inviting me. Good to have you. I'm glad to be had.
Let's get down to basics. I used the word compromario.
Yes.
Would you explain for us exactly what a compromario tenor does?
Yes, it's the second banana.
The second banana to the first tenor.
To the first tenor, or in some case, well, yeah, to the first tenor. But he's sort of the, we think of it as character because it's a lot of character and there's a lot of acting within developing the roles. And the singing is, he just doesn't have the leading roles. So vocally, you don't have that stress of the weight of carrying a show, but you're there as an integral part. What would happen to Butterfly if there was no Goro? You know, same. Now, if they didn't have any Borsa, the Duke would still exist.
So in other words, that this kind of characters, it plays the very important ingredient, but they are not take the leash.
Right, exactly. The pressure of leading is not on their shoulder, but supporting so that there is a homogeneous feeling throughout the opera, so that it becomes an ensemble piece, regardless, even if it isn't Mozart and happens to be Puccini, there's still a connecting, that these figures connect so that things continue.
So you were in the Met for 27
years. 860 performances.
At the Met, like other great opera houses, there is a real tradition of compromario roles.
Yes.
And you are in a line of people like Charles Anthony, Andrea Velez. Who back then did you learn from, or who did you admire when you were starting this direction?
Well, it's interesting because I was in New Orleans, and the same time I was getting a lot of work with the New Orleans Opera, Jimmy Atherton, God rest his soul, was getting a lot of work at the Met. So it was sort of balancing that. But when I got to the Met, they were all very kind, but Andrea Velez was the one that I learned the most from. And Charlie, too. I mean, he was there the first day and, you know, took care of me, well, like my father. But Andy, in his own way, was very welcoming. And I think it was because he remembered when he first got to the company and Alessio De Palos was there. De Palos was not very friendly to Andy, you know, was threatened by Andy. And Andy never felt that way. And we did pretty much shared all the roles, Andy and I, of the same, you know, the Hoffman people, the Simpleton and Boris, everything. We, Trabuco, everything we shared. And it was I miss him.
Did he teach you staging, the character
things? No, I came with that package already in my back pocket.
What is the best things did you learn from him?
The subtlety in which he worked, his subtlety. And I watched him and studied him, as I did whoever came, you know.
Such as?
Charlie, in some ways. Nico, in many
ways. Nico Castel.
Nico was very etched in his characterizations. I have to say Joey Frank. And then watching all the principal artists, how they did their things, you know, and the elegance. And then realizing how important things that I hadn't thought about because I just did, how important the music is to make the body move. And how important it is to use a technique to interpret what the composer is saying so that you're taking a small little role and making it a major statement so that when you come on stage, if it's for 5 minutes, 25 minutes, the audience bends and says, that's Anthony. Mm. You know.
Did you ever in the early years aspire to be the leading tenor?
Oh, sure. There's not a singer in the world that doesn't start. And in my case, it was Enrico Caruso. And then, you know, I'm studying. I want to sing like Enrico Caruso. We're the same height. I can do leading roles. Well, I could have, and it would all have been Mozart and Rossini, because that was where my voice was. And then Arthur Cosenza in New Orleans Opera said, you know, you really should specialize. And then when all the Met singers would come to New Orleans to sing, and I was doing my stuff, say, Anthony, you should really specialize. And I would say, I've studied. So I said, listen, there's only one way I'll be at the Metropolitan Opera. If God says I'm supposed to be as a character artist, a comprimario, then I'll be at the Met doing it. Ta-da. 27 years. 27 happy years. Mm.
Do you miss it today?
No.
You don't?
I'm so busy now working with young people that it's just a joy, because now I have that feeling of I'm giving everything I learned and seeing how they can make it fit in their body. I do, matter of fact, the 15th of this month, I'm doing a master class, an intensive four-hour workshop.
Wow.
For whoever comes. I have 10. I mean, I opened it for 10 because you can only work so that you feel as though if you're going to pay $200, I'm not going to sit there and only work 15 minutes. No, I move them a lot of acting, a lot of singing and acting at the same time, and no voice lessons. It's not my business. If you want to come and understand where the composer's going, if your technique matches that, then you're not going to have a problem. But if there's a faulty technique, then you can't do what I'm asking or what the composer asks to do in a phrase.
Then what do you tell him? Do you tell him to go fix it someplace? Or
I would make a suggestion and say, talk to your teacher. This is what I hear. But I said, at the moment, I'm just concerned that you understand how to sit in a chair, how to hold a mug, how to use the mug, instead of just saying, Avramietta di Mascarella notte del Duce Viscontino, Violetta d'Alfredo Anco, Nano Vita Giorate. And all of a sudden, we have a cup here floating in air when you can use the cup and take a sip.
So do you ever feel like on stage that you feel you are doing too much, doing too little?
That's a great question. Everybody said I did too much. I would walk into a rehearsal, and the assistant director, the director, would say, too much. I said, what the? We haven't started rehearsing yet, but I know you're going to do too much. I said, sure, okay, I'll do what you want here. For 4,000 people, they know what to expect, and that's what they want from Anthony.
Right.
So I would hone everything down, but I always wanted to make sure, and still do, that there's a little sparkle, that it doesn't look vanilla, but that it has some interesting qualities, you know?
So you originally from
New Orleans, Jersey?
New Orleans.
No, New Orleans, Louisiana.
Oh.
Originally from New Orleans. Nobody ever thought when I lived in New Orleans that I was from New Orleans. They thought
I
was
from Italy.
New York. Oh, no, not even from Italy. Well, I thought I was from New York.
Uh-huh.
Your parents came from Italy, right, or your grandparents?
My grandparents did, but my father couldn't speak English for quite a long time. Born in America, but the whole situation. But
right.
No, they immigrated from Italy to New Orleans, the port of embarkation there, the custom house in New Orleans. They didn't come through Ellis Island. A lot of the Sicilians, because primarily New Orleans is all Sicilians. So,
how did you start when you were young?
I started entertaining my family at 4, doing Louis Armstrong impersonations and Jimmy Durante impersonations. And I would do that. They'd take me to a store we used to frequent and put me up on the glass, and I would do shows for these people at 4. And then we was a famous furniture store in New Orleans, Rosenberg's, and my mother would get furniture from them, and I would go with her, and Mr. Simon would say, why don't you sing some Sicilian songs up and down in the elevator? I said, $10. Yeah, what are you going to do? I should have asked for more. He's the only recording of me as a boy soprano is one of these recordings that he made, 3. I don't know where they are, but I have mine. And it's kind of interesting to hear me as a boy soprano because it was not that la voce bianco, come in italiano, but la voce with the appoggiare, the appoggia, the abdomen, and the high-domed palate with a low laryngeal position. So it sounded like, is it a woman? Is it the last one of the few castratos? Or what is it? And it's a boy singing. It's kind of interesting.
So did your parents promote
love
this? They loved this, and they wanted you.
My father was so thrilled.
Hmm.
I remember I started at 10 studying. And I remember the teacher said, whom I stayed with for 17 years, true Italian bel canto technique. However, he was English. Paddock. Charles Paddock was his name. And studied at the Comunale. And in those days, everybody, you know, we got connected. You sang with your body. It wasn't this stuff, you know. So 17 years I worked with him in a solid bel canto technique. And it all seemed to work.
So at home, you just sing all the time?
Well, I studied, you know, practice at home, but then I would sing. And then I did a lot of stuff. You know, you did a lot of things when you were a boy soprano. And then when the voice changes, I was a gopher. I made my operatic debut at 11 years old singing The Street Urchin in Charpentier's Louise with the New Orleans Opera, Norman Traeger, Marietta Muse, Dorothy Kirsten. It was an unbelievable. Half the other, you know, it's a large opera with a lot of character parts. Bobby Nagy, a whole slew of people that 20 years later, I would be on the stage with at the Met. And it's crazy. It's great, isn't it?
In what age do you think that you say, okay, I am going to be an opera singer?
Oh, I was 10 years old.
Just 10? Really? Just 10?
Oh, yeah. And people used to tell my father, they'd say, well, now, Anthony, what would you? Because I studied piano, but I was a lousy pianist. So at the piano recital, I would play, and then I would sing. And I remember doing, there's an arrangement of Home on the Range where it just goes crazy, and I would sing that. So after it was over, people said, well, now, what do you want to do, Anthony? And I said, oh, I'm going to sing at the Metropolitan Opera. I said, I'll do my undergraduate at Loyola University, and then I will go to Italy and study some more, and then I will sing at the Metropolitan Opera.
How did you know Metropolitan Opera at 10 years old?
Because I was a precocious little child. Once I decided that, you know, at 10 years old, I was in the boys' choir for Tosca, okay? Mm-hmm. When the Scarpia, Cesare Bardelli, came out on the stage with the cape and the hair, and I leaned over to my father, especially in the second act. Well, I'm on the stage for the first act, and the director at that time, Arthur Cosenza, gave me extra little bits, you know, with the Statue of the Blessed Mother and stuff like that. And when I saw him come out, I thought, that's it. That's what I'm going to do. And when I was sitting up for the second act with my father watching it, the old New Orleans was in the auditorium, like when we played Cleveland and those places, just this huge place where it was, wait, they had the circus, and then the half of it we cut down and you have the opera.
Right.
So I leaned over, I said, that's what I'm going to do with the rest of my life. And my father cried and said, I'm so happy.
Mm. Oh, really?
Oh, yeah.
Why?
He loved it. My father couldn't sing or carry or hear a pitch, but loved every minute of it. He went to a girl, took a girl out and said, would you like to go to the opera? And she said, why? You don't understand anything. You know, he said, oh, you know, you're right. You don't. He said, but I know you love, she said, I know I have canaries and everything in the house. And they sing so beautifully. Oh, and my father said, what are they saying? And she said, oh, Tony, I see what you mean. So come to the opera. You know, he always loved it as a child.
And your mother?
My mother loved us. So whatever we loved, it was fine for her.
She wasn't musical either.
She was. She could hear a tone, sound like a cat, and she played the clarinet. Uh-huh. But my mother went to high school. My father went to the sixth grade, and that was it. And I learned more about everything from my father, who went to the sixth grade, than anyone except for Charlie Anthony that I ever met. Anything about life and experiences and careers and all of those kind of things I got so much from Charlie, and how to deal with people I got from my father.
When did you leave New Orleans?
1979, moved to Brooklyn, New York.
How old were you?
I was 31.
Uh-huh.
30? No, I was 29. Mm-hmm. I was 29, yeah. And then I freelanced for a while, and then I did an audition at the Met, and I was walking on the street, and people said, congratulations. And I said, thank you.
So from 10 years old to 29,
you
just consistently doing this.
Oh, yeah. Sang with the New Orleans Symphony. Werner Tokarnowski. I don't know if you ever remember Werner Tokarnowski. Very elaborate conductor. Pals with Norman Traeger, who was one of my mentors in a sense. Got me my first church job. My First Baptist Church. Biggest Baptist church in New Orleans, and pretty much one of the biggest ones within the Baptist, Southern Baptist Convention. I sang there. I sang gospel like you wouldn't believe, a little 15-year-old boy. I didn't have high notes. I was screaming my guts out on B-flats and A's, and had got those amens because I studied from, I watched Norman so much and so intently, and I watched how he delivered, and his whole body was in the name of Jesus is so sweet. And I would watch the congregation and it all go.
Yeah.
Said, he had him right there, you know. It's great. 15, I figured. I'll remember that.
How did the audition at the Met come about? Did you request it?
Yes. Claudia Catania. We were doing Eugene Onegin in Baltimore, Lyric Opera of Baltimore. And she said, you know, you really should sing for Larry Stair. I said, I'll sing for anybody. You know, I was that kind of, you know, I sang for so many managements that I said, well, no. And I got recommended by the heads of companies and to sing for their company, for the person that was in charge of the voice. Soon as I got my contract at the Met, out of the woodwork, like you're in Italy and you walk away from your wife and all these Italians come out of the woodwork, boom, I had more agents. I said, well, you with somebody? I said, yes, Jim Scovotti. Well, are you I said, yes, not only am I happy with him, but I'm glad you didn't listen to me. I'm glad I didn't audition for you because I'm very happy. And this man works for me. So Pasta Così, that's how that occurred. But I did the screening audition in List Hall for Larry and for Joan Ingpen.
Do you remember what you sang?
Oh, very definitely. Me preamble. Joan Ingpen was the judge in New Orleans when I won third place for the regional area.
For National Council.
For National Council. And she told me, the comments in those days, you get to read the comments, your appearance is passable for a tenor. And you have to leave New Orleans if you want a career. Don't you think that was profound? So after that, 2 years later, I'm singing in List Hall, and I sang Beppe's aria. And then Larry looked at everything else I had down there. He said, well, that's really good. That's really fine. I said, you know, though, Mr. Stayer, I'd love to sing for you a typical tune of Zanzibar from John Philip Sousa's El Capitan. He said, we would never do that. I said, of course you would never do that here. But it's everything you want to know about Anthony Laciura but was afraid to ask. At which point, Joe was playing the piano for me. And he was a very proper man, you know. He went, he did just like that. I could hear him go, oh, Anthony. So Larry said, well, it seems like you want. I said, you could stop me. It's three strophes, and you can stop me whenever you want. So they said, all right, let's do it. So I started my little tune of Zanzibar. And then they started going, and I continued. And then Joan Ingpen started going, ah, 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 and by the third verse, she's going, ah, ha, ha, ha. And then I realized who it was at that point because her teeth. So I said, look, I'm just singing for the woman. So they stood up, thanked me for entertaining them. Secondly, Larry said, Jimmy Levine's got to hear and see this. So September the 15th of that year, I had my stage audition, and I sang for Jimmy, and every time I would sing, and I sang a typical tune of Zanzibar with the set was Das Rheingold, the old one, the Carrion, Wieland Wagner, where Birgit comes out with the helmet on, with the lights, but she said, well, I can't see anything. It was all in dark. I'm doing, ya, 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 ya. So, and after that's over, Jimmy said, well, and everybody in the house was there. I couldn't see him, but all the upper echelon was there, you know. So he said, what else do you have, Anthony? Well, I sang everything. And so finally, he said, well, Maestro, that's all I have. He said, do you mind if we keep asking? I said, no, not at all. I said, listen, I'm having a great time, and I really feel comfortable here. So on the, that was the 15th of September, and on the 16th, they called and offered me a contract. Now, a preamble to that is every time the phone would ring previous to that, Joe, I would say, oh, get that, Anthony, it's the Metropolitan Opera. For years, we lived in New Orleans, and then especially when we came back and lived in Brooklyn. So sure enough, she answered the phone. It was Larry Stayer. Hello, this is Larry Stayer from the Metropolitan Opera. May I speak with Anthony? And Joelle handed me the phone like... So my God, what's wrong? I said, oh, Mr. Stayer, and I explained the whole story to him. Well, he loved that. He loved, oh, I love those guys. I said, sure, you call somebody, say, hello, this is the President of the United States. Hello, this is Pope Francis. Just wanted to call and say hi. I'm in a neighborhood in Teaneck, wanted to stop and say hi. Well, it's the same thing for a singer.
So what did they offer you, one opera or a season?
Oh, my God, no. I was... offered the plan artist.
Right at the beginning.
Right at the beginning. He offered me a plan artist contract, and I did 108 or 9 performances on stage, and then 24 more on tour that year. So they used to try to figure out what your stamina, and I showed them that I had quite a lot of stamina. And then I eventually started doing 8 to 9 different roles a season. You know, so it was, I did all right.
After that audition, how long did you have to wait?
Oh, August. That was in September. No, and they wanted me to come on tour with them to do The Sergeant and something else, but I couldn't. I had already had contracts with, not Glimmer Glass, but Central City. So I couldn't go on the 82 tour, but so I started August of 82. And
what were you thinking? During that period of time, you were waiting.
I was going to be a Metropolitan Opera singer. The same thing. I knew I was going to be
for 10 years
old. You
definitely have that confidence, huh?
Yeah.
Even after
great?
All that time, they didn't call you, but you think going to call you.
Oh, no. Well, no, but they did. That's what I'm saying.
Yes.
The next day. But then I went off and did more things because Jim was my manager at that time, and he kept getting me work all over the place. Matter of fact, I did. I got my equity card by doing Detlef and covering the Prince in Student Prince with Carlton Davis, who was a ballet dancer at the Met years and years ago when Gildo D'Annunzio was, and then he was in the chorus as well. So he would cast all of these operettas and musical comedies with real voices, with real big-time voices. So I got my equity card, which paid off nicely for me now because I kept paying my dues, and... It's crazy how...
But listen to you. It seems to me that your early career is very rosy. Is that true? I mean, honestly.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah?
But it was.
Yes.
It was.
That's
I did
wonderful.
So much work in New Orleans. Everything that happened, I sang. Uh-huh. Especially being at Loyola, whatever it was. I was on the radio, on the television, just constantly. So me coming to New York, I was very prepared, but I knew... After undergraduate that I was not ready because I didn't feel my technique was strong enough and I knew I had no money to study. And in those days, studying was like $20 a lesson and it was $15 an hour to coach with somebody. So when I did all these roles, all of the roles, I studied on my own. Then I listened to the recording and coached with the recording just to get, can you imagine doing... Pong in Turandot with a little record. I had a little tape record. I'd press it. I'd work 8 measures. Then I'd sing 8 measures, memorize. Good. Go to the next one. And then finally, I saved enough money to coach with somebody before I went, 2 or 3 if I had the money.
Hold on to that right there. We have to, unfortunately, take a break.
Oh.
We'll be right back.
Okay.
But we are visiting today with Anthony Laciura. This is Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis.